joining me up here. Let's give a clap to our panelists. We seek to collectively reflect on progress made in the continent since the launch of the campaign to end child marriage in Africa, and lastly, to foster dialogue between key actors working to end child marriage in Africa, including opportunities for civil society engagement. Now, before we get into all these interesting and exciting aspects, I would like to introduce to you my esteemed panel. This introduction will take on a slightly different format from what you're used to or accustomed to. I would ask each of my panelists to start their introduction with their names and organization, but thereafter, they will think of an animal that best describes them and how the characteristics of that animal are useful or could be useful in their work for end child marriage. Let's begin with Kathy.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. Is it still morning?
Yes.
I'm a bit different than I am. So my name is Kathurima. I am the advocacy officer at FEMNET. FEMNET is the African Women's Development and Communications Network. We are a Pan-African feminist network. We have members and organizations and individuals across all the regions of Africa. And so my animal is the rabbit. I hope to be as clever, shrewd, and cunning as a rabbit to be able to ensure that in one generation, we are able to do patriarchy, as we all mentioned this morning, and be able to end child marriage. I look forward to engaging you this morning. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Nyaradzayi, the Elisis Patriarchy. I'm Nyaradzayi. I am the founder and chief executive of Rozaria Memorial Trust, which I founded in honor of my late mother who experienced child marriage. It's based in Zimbabwe, I live in a village in Zimbabwe, working collaboratively with many partners. A shout out to many of them who are here. And I also serve as the African Union Goodwill Ambassador for ending child marriage. I am an angry mother hen. I am a mother hen, we lay the eggs, we want those chicks to be hatched. We don't want any eagles to take them. We really need a good nest. I'm a mother hen.
Thank you,
Nancy. Merci, bonjour à tout le monde. Mon nom est Morissanda Kouyate, Kouyate. Je suis le directeur exécutif du comité interafricain sur les pratiques affectant la santé des femmes et des enfants. Le comité interafricain est une organisation africaine, internationale, dont je suis allé à Addis Abeba. Et j'ai l'honneur de savoir que la présidente du comité interafricain, Mme Maria Mbanizana, est aussi avec nous. Donc nous sommes très bien de présenter. Elle est là. Voilà, je ne la voyais pas. Donc c'est en son nom et au nom de l'organisation que je participe à l'animation de cette session. Merci. Et je pense à un animal, c'est un poisson, qui s'appelle le piranha. Le piranha, quel que soit l'objectif, quelle que soit sa proie, lorsqu'il fonce là-dessus, en quelques secondes, la proie disparaît tout de suite. Donc je pense que si Valéa et Antoine est une proie, nous devons être des piranhas pour les dévorer en quelques secondes. Merci.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Patience Mpani. I am the program manager for the Women's Rights Unit at the Center for Human Rights at the University of Pretoria. The Center for Human Rights is part of an academic institution because we are housed in the law school at the University of Pretoria, but we are also an NGO. And the Women's Rights Unit, where I come from, is on the NGO side of the work of the center. And what we do is we support the mandate of the Special Rapporteur on the Rights of Women in Africa, providing them with technical support as well as research and capacity building support. With regards to the animal that I think best amplifies the work that we do, I think it will be a lioness. I like the lioness because it is class and it has got. And it's very nurturing, so it is the one that defends the young ones. And also, it works with other lionesses when it is hunting, so there's a very girl power kind of attitude that comes with the lion, and that is why I think it is the best animal to describe the work that we do. Thank you.
Thanks, Patience, and thank you all for your introductions. Just building from what you said in terms of setting the stage. Patience, could you tell us what
were
some 2 to 3 findings from the study that you conducted on
ending
child marriage in Africa?
So the Center for Human Rights was involved in a study on ending child marriages in Africa. I must say that our statistics are a bit outdated because the study itself was conducted in 2014. It was a 10-country study that looked at, and the countries were selected to try to show the different regions of Africa, but also focusing on countries with the highest prevalence at that time. We were trying to look at the causes, the context, and the prevalence of child marriage on the continent. And what this study found, of course, was that gender inequality is a main concern that drives child marriages, and also it in itself is a consequence of child marriage, that we need to be looking at addressing root causes of child marriage if we are going to be able to deal with it. So issues around patriarchy, and it manifests itself through religious and cultural attitudes, issues around poverty, and issues around education of the girl child were some of the more prominent issues that came out of the study.
Okay.
Nyaradzayi,
at the opening ceremony, you talked about the extension of the 2021, and in setting the context for this session, I'd like you to go into details as to what was the political climate at the time the campaign was being launched. What was the will that led to this momentum around ending child marriage?
This was a confluence of processes that we have been at the regional level and at the international level. As you know, as Africa, we're working on Agenda 2063. And all the time we would hit the snag, where are the girls, what is happening to the girls? We were reviewing our work around the African child on the rights of welfare of the child. And all the time the issues of girls were coming up. And we were working on the SDG processes, and the issue was coming up. So it became an imperative that we must address the issue of child marriage as one of those critical indicators which addresses the multiplicity of issues. And definitely what we did was political will, an extraordinary mobilization of countries, is the launch, is an approach that we need to have national launches. But at the same time, it meant we needed to have a common approach. And so in 2015, we saw the African heads of states adopt the Africa common position on ending child marriage so that there is a clearly identified set of issues. An extraordinary mobilization by civil society. I think for me what was exciting in the last 4 years of the campaign was to see the ownership of the continent, not just by governments, but also by civil society. And really, the multilateral partners, the bilateral partners, are standing solid with Africa in terms of unleashing those conversations. What and then, so if you allow me to then briefly say, therefore, what did we see in the last couple of years since the launch? The launch was May 2014. So we saw unprecedented efforts at the normative level. So at the normative level, the Africa Common Position I talked about, a number of countries working towards legislation. We saw the general comment as part of the normative, and we saw work by UNFP and other partners, UN Women and Planet, and the work on laws, just compendium, just understanding where are the gaps. But then we was a sustained work on convening. Real strategic convening, systematic over time, the president of Chad, president, appointment of President Lungu, and sustaining the presence of conversation at the AU summit, and recently we saw African governments for the first time taking the leadership at the UN level on the issue of child marriage. Previously, we would see Canada, Netherlands, UK as countries stepping up on it, but this time we saw African heads of states, African governments, whether it's CSW, AGA, General Assembly, leading in the convening. But a civil society were also innovating. And part of that innovation was an extraordinary effort to convene in our regions. Congratulations to the West Africa big event. That was exciting, exciting high-level meeting that we had in West Africa. That was civil society-led in many ways, plans and the children, national networks that we saw there, but also in Southern Africa. All the way around the SADC model, the work we are doing with IM, with Warren, with NGOCC, and many other partners. So what I thought I could do in order to answer your question is to prepare my report. That is, any good ambassador, I need to really document the last four years of work so that there is a very succinct analysis which gives us the insights. And the second question, approaches and norms, which is my last comment on your question. We need to start to question language, and that is really emerging in my work very strongly. We need to nuance the analysis. We need to build on some of the work that has happened, like the World Bank research on the economic impact. We cannot have, child marriage is not a mono-narrative on the continent. It's a complex narrative, which requires a complex response.
Thanks, Yaris. I'm going to the report that you have to develop later into the session, but I just want to pick up on something you mentioned, which is the important role of civil society in not only pushing the campaign objectives forward, but in addressing child marriage in Africa. And I want to talk to Dr. Kouyate and Catherine. Coming from membership organizations, how do you feel the campaign has helped you in terms of pushing your own organization's objectives on gender equality? We'll start with Catherine and then we'll come to Dr. Kouyate.
Yeah, thank you. So in terms of the role of civil society organization, and I speak particularly from the perspectives of women's rights organization, there have been a lot of ongoing effort and work, in particular towards pushing for ratification for documents and commitments like the Maputo Protocol. So what the campaign does, it provides an opportunity to revitalize those kind of efforts, you know, to inject new energy, and most importantly, as we learned in the morning, it has new actors speaking about various components of commitments like Maputo Protocol. And what that tells is that when we're pushing for ratification and domestication, for example, national reports become much more nuanced. They start to focus more on broader issues of gender equality and women's empowerment. And the other thing I also want to mention is that at the national level, you don't just have revitalized conversations of gender equality and child marriage, but also movements working towards ending gender inequality with different formations. And what conversations of child marriage, any child marriage has provided, they start to provide clarity as to what gender equality looks like. You know, previously we hadn't seen how we hadn't seen girls as being impacted by these issues, but now we start to profile what this looks like, the effect it has on girls and women, and that also does provide momentum in terms of articulating to governments where priorities and investments need to go to, and so that really helps. And at the same time, regionally and globally, it starts to provide very specific issues in countries, because as she says, in a national context, child marriages look differently. In countries, for example, when you have a child marriage conversation, you definitely have to think about leadership. You definitely have to think about these disparities in terms of where it's happening in the country. And so we start to get a bit more granular in terms of the gaps we need, the gaps we need to address, and the solutions we need to be putting forward. And as she mentioned again, there are opportunities for us to profile previously ignored or things that have not come to the limelight in terms of innovations. So we start to understand how we can work together in multi-stakeholder collaboration. And so for me, I think it's an opportunity for partnership. It's an opportunity for renewed conversation. But then finally, also space opens up. So we did have traditionally some actors speaking of gender inequality, but now they start, they are also seen as part of women's rights organizing, or they then provide an opportunity to support them to other members. That's a good thing.
Okay. And Dr. Kouyate, just building on what Nyaradzayi and Catherine have said, you are there and this is the launch of the campaign, and you're working on harmful practices in general. So how do you think the campaign on ending child marriage with other campaigns like ending and how do
your membership
work on
these issues? Merci beaucoup. Comme je disais tout à l'heure, le comité interafricain qui a été créé en 1984, donc il y a 34 ans, avait déjà fixé comme objectif à sa création la lutte contre toute forme de pratique traditionnelle affectant la santé des femmes et des enfants. Et parmi les deux objectifs les plus importants du comité interafricain à sa création, il y avait le mariage des enfants et la mutilation génitale féminine. Donc ça fait 34 ans que le comité interafricain avait commencé à alerter le monde sur la dangerosité des mutilations génitales féminines, des mariages des enfants et autres pratiques traditionnelles. Et comme le comité interafricain a un statut d'observateur auprès de l'Union africaine et des Nations unies, et comme le comité a sa base à Addis Abeba auprès de l'Union africaine, nous avons participé de façon très ferme, de façon très engagée à tous les programmes développés pour finir avec les mutilations génitales. Et ce que nous avons vu, c'est que pendant ces 30 années passées, nous, en tant qu'ONG, nous avons fait de la sensibilisation, nous avons fait du plaidoyer, mais c'est seulement à l'implication de l'Union africaine que notre travail a été plus visible et plus rentable. La leçon qu'il faut tirer, c'est que nous devons repenser un peu la collaboration de la société civile avec les gouvernements et les organisations internationales, régionales ou sous-régionales. Et longtemps, nous avons eu un paradigme d'opposition en disant au gouvernement, vous ne faites pas les choses en bonne forme, en disant à l'Union africaine, vous n'êtes pas à la bonne place, vous n'avez pas la bonne responsabilité. Mais quand nous avons changé le paradigme, c'est-à-dire en passant de la dénonciation, de l'opposition à la collaboration, nous avons vu tout de suite les résultats, surtout les mariages. Et nous sommes très fiers en tant qu'Africains, parce que chaque fois que on parle d'Afrique, c'est toujours en arrière. Nous sommes en arrière, nous ne sommes pas développés, nous sommes ceci, nous sommes cela. Mais dans le domaine du respect de la promotion des droits des femmes, des enfants et des filles, je pense qu'il n'y a pas une seule région dans le monde qui puisse être avant l'Union africaine, avant la région africaine. Et le programme dont nous parlons, le programme de l'Union africaine, nous avons été associés à cela. Nous avons travaillé ensemble, la société civile, l'Union africaine et les gouvernements. Et le résultat a été le suivant, c'est que les programmes ont été lancés dans les pays respectifs. Et comme l'a dit tout à l'heure l'ambassadrice de bonne volonté, nous avons fait de pays en pays pour lancer, pour faire de cela une priorité. Parce qu'on a beau dire, ce qu'il faut d'abord, c'est la volonté politique. S'il n'y a pas l'implication des gouvernements, s'il n'y a pas l'implication des chefs d'État, on ne va nulle part. Alors, nous avons la chance d'avoir au niveau africain trois choses. Nous avons une société civile très engagée, très dynamique, et je voudrais saluer vraiment la société civile africaine ici, qui ne cesse de travailler de façon dure pour pousser la région africaine. Ça, c'est vraiment. Deuxièmement, nous avons la chance d'avoir une fois plus l'Union africaine qui est en avance sur ces questions et qui met ces questions au niveau régional. Quand nous prenons le protocole à la Charte africaine des droits de l'homme et des peuples, le protocole de Maputo, c'est l'un des textes les plus avancés au monde dans le domaine de la protection et les droits des femmes et des enfants. Et là-dedans, nous avons le mariage des enfants et la mutilation génitale. Alors, pour finir la réponse à votre question, je dois dire que toutes ces questions se tiennent. On ne peut pas dire, voilà, ce sont les mutilations génitales féminines qui sont prioritaires ou ce sont les maladies d'enfants qui sont prioritaires. Toutes ces questions sont hyper prioritaires pour la jeune fille. Parce qu'on peut mettre la priorité quand on n'est pas la cible. Mais quand on est la cible, quand on est l'objectif même, quand on est visé par ces pratiques, on ne peut pas faire le choix. Alors, ce qu'il faut, c'est de prendre toutes ces pratiques. C'est pourquoi nous nous disons pratiques traditionnelles affectant la santé et les droits des femmes et des enfants. C'est de prendre toutes ces choses ensemble, d'autant plus que c'est la même chose. Pour lutter contre les mariages d'enfants, on ne passe que par la loi, par la sensibilisation, par le plaidoyer. Pour lutter contre les mariages d'enfants, c'est la même chose. Donc, étant donné que c'est le même processus, ce serait bien de mettre tout ça dans le même paquet comme nous le faisons au niveau africain et de faire avancer la lutte.
Thank you. Okay, thank you very much. I want to build up on what you said. Africa has one of the most progressive policy frameworks in terms of addressing women's rights, and that's the Maputo Protocol. And building on what Mabel said in the introduction at the opening ceremony, is we cannot address girls in different, it has to be a holistic intervention. We can't be saying SRA child on Monday, FGM on Tuesday, child marriage on Wednesday. So looking at the Maputo Protocol, patients, we are celebrating 15 years since the adoption of the Maputo Protocol. How do you feel this is going to be an opportunity for us advocates working on ending child marriage to create those linkages and synergies that are required in the continent to help end this bad practice?
Thank you, Yvette. Yes, certainly the Maputo Protocol turns 15 this year on the 11th of July, so very soon, it is turning 15. And I think this is an important milestone for all of us to look back and reflect on what we have achieved as women's rights organizations or as Africa. What is it that we have achieved? We've got this very progressive instrument, which is probably the best in terms of protection of women's rights. Are we implementing it in the way that was envisaged when this protocol was designed? Article 6B of the Maputo Protocol speaks to child marriages, and it is very clear that marriages should be from full consent, that the minimum age of marriage should be 18. But for example, we see that in Africa we have a number of countries who still practice customary law, for example, or religious law, for example, that allows marriages to take place with children under the age of 18. What have we done as African countries to harmonize those laws? What have we done as civil society to popularize protocol so that the individual women who should be benefiting from the protocol know about it? One of the interesting things that we've done as the Center for Human Rights is we have gone out and asked women randomly, men and women randomly,
Nairobi, including university students, where we are housed at the University of Pretoria, what is the Maputo Protocol? Some people think that it is something that has to do with Mozambique. So you find that people do not know about the Maputo Protocol. So they are less likely to evoke it in situations where they are likely to be violated. We want to see more use of the Maputo Protocol in courts. We want to see a lot of government state parties reporting on the implementation of the Maputo Protocol. It is 15 years since the adoption of the Maputo Protocol. We have 14 countries that are still yet to ratify the Maputo Protocol. We need to be putting pressure on them to ratify. We also have state parties who have ratified the Maputo Protocol with reservations. Some of them even have reservations for child marriages. We need to see those reservations lifted as an example. So there are many, many ways that we should be engaging with the protocol. And most important among it is, are we actually knowledgeable about the protocol ourselves as practitioners, and do the communities that need to know it know about it? And so this 15 years is an opportunity for us to really bring light to the presence of the protocol and the potential that it has for advancing women's rights.
Thank you. At the youth takeover in the opening, we have been informed that we cannot do anything without engaging the youth. Kathurima, there are renewed conversations on the continent around the demographic dividend. Tell us more about this and how this can be an instrument for us to push the need to fight child marriage.
Thank you. Yeah, I agree with you that there can be nothing without us. For us without us, but I don't feel so much youth anymore.
As young as you feel.
Yes, at heart. So one of the most important things that conversation that the demographic dividend will provide is a conceptual framework for us to start elaborating the diversity of young people. A lot of times when we discuss young people, really we are discussing young men and boys most of the time, particularly when we start discussing youth as actors. You know, and participants and experts in these conversations. And we normally discuss young women and adolescent girls either as recipients of policies, beneficiaries, or victims of some of the issues we are discussing. And so in terms of how the demographic dividend priorities are outlined, each of the pillars does provide an opportunity for us to discuss and elaborate how child marriage fits in. If you look at the pillar of health, for example, you start elaborating now and hearing nuance as to what kind of girls' health needs are. You cannot finish that conversation without articulating sexual reproductive health and rights for adolescent girls, which means the agency to control your own body, the choices you make, you know, and the voice that you're provided for in terms of articulating what your priorities are. If you discuss education and how child marriage, for example, is a hindrance for girls' education. You know, when you discuss employment, so how are girls who end up in marriage, or as Mother Marissa puts it, systematic sexual exploitation, how do they end up becoming dependable, you know? And in terms of governance, how do you then, and civic participation, there are two pillars to that, you know? Girls who end up in child marriages are often stuck in unpaid care work, and they will never be able to be part of social movements. So they will never become the girls and the young men sitting on this panel articulating what child marriage is in policy and programs. And on the other hand, if there is no laws and legal systems in place for us to ensure that we are able to criminalize child marriages, then we're not able to be able to fully articulate the governance component. So I feel like the outline of those four priorities is important at the regional level. At the national level, when countries are making national road plans, it is important for us to start getting granular as to what particular health, as to what particular needs are for different components of young people. We have young people in urban areas, we have young people in rural areas, young people are diverse, and as you know, that includes adolescent girls and young women. And most of the times, they do bear the disproportionate burden of all these violations. They are the ones who are the face of the HIV epidemic, they are the ones who are the face of the unsafe abortion, they are the ones who are dying from adolescent maternal mortality. So if you really have to have the demographic dividend conversations, we must start ensuring we put girls and young men at the center of it. And then I also look at it at the point of
The demographic dividend conversation does provide an opportunity for us to continue conversation about the protocol, right? So we cannot have this conversation separately. We need a young feminist dividend with the demographic dividend conversation itself.
Thank you very much. There's a wealth of experience that has been shared by the panelists. But I want to now open up the floor to you, our studio audience and our audience at home, which will be facilitated by my colleagues. I want to start with those present here. Do you have any questions or any contributions that you want to make towards some of the things that have been discussed and towards other issues that are coming up on the continent in terms of addressing child marriage? We have some mics that will be moving. Any questions? Are we certain Africa has solved child marriage? We have nothing to add again? Doris.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Doris. I know patriarchy, so I will not call on my father's name, so I'm the African Union representative for Save the Children and director of the Pan Africa office. I'm based in Addis Ababa. Thank you very much for putting together this panel, very inspiring discussion. I just want to make a contribution regarding to what the AU campaign on child marriage. I think the campaign has been successful to some extent, especially in terms of launching national campaigns, and also in some countries, the campaign has been a catalyst in developing and adopting, and to some extent also implementing national strategies to end child marriage. But I think what is missing here, at the, especially at the Pan-Africa level, is the accountability. We have great policy framework. Article 21 of the African Charter on the Rights and Welfare of the Child also criminalizes and child marriage. We just talked about the Maputo Protocol, and and the African Common African Position on ending child marriage. So the policy framework is there and it's quite robust. What is missing, as I said, is the accountability mechanism. In 2016, including thanks to Nyaradzayi, our goodwill ambassador, we had an AU ministerial decision that calls for the establishment of a forum, an accountability mechanism. They call it, because the word accountability is quite, is still sensitive in the African context, and the AU with member states specifically. So they're calling it a monitoring and follow-up mechanism. So I think it's important to put that really at the center of our discussions. There's work that has been done by President Deli and also currently with President of Zambia, President Lungu, who have called on other heads of states to come together and report back on what's happening on ending child marriage throughout the continent. So that's something I think as a community here that we can build on. There's political will to bring other heads of states to have a pan-African accountability mechanism on ending child marriage. And so that's really something that needs attention, needs support, and needs resourcing. And I think all of us can coalesce and lobby to make that possible. One opportunity is the next head of state meeting in January during the AU summit, where we can collectively ask for leadership from President Lungu, who's the AU champion of ending child marriage, to establish really that accountability mechanism on ending child marriage. Thank you.
Thanks, Doris. Let's just pass on to the
Thank you very much, Madam Moderator. I would like to appreciate the contribution by the panelists. My name is Ngwase. I'm coming from Zambia, where our president is indeed the champion of ending child marriages. Within the aspect of accountability,
I think we would also want to add what the need for broad-based resourcing of civil society networks working around any child marriage. Because I think since morning, we have been discussing and conversations around how community-led initiatives have actually brought about a change and have the potential to open up more opportunities, you know, to be able to ensure that engagements of any child marriage are actually taken right up to the local level. I mean, as network organizations, I think the need to, for this conference to resolve around the need to adequately resource, you know, the role of civil society organization to reignite the community voices, but also to open up more opportunities for the communities to raise their voices. I mean, even just coming to attend a conference like this, we'll find that the communities whose voices are so critical, you know, on the panels, to be able to speak for themselves, the experiences within their own area, is such a difficult task. And therefore, that again, we'll find in most cases, that role is placed upon civil society to mobilize, to organize. So I think the need to be able to ensure that we leave the acceleration, but also the need to strengthen the role of civil society in this fight is very critical. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Ngwase. I'm sure within the course of the 3 days, you'll have a way forward in terms of support for resourcing for community-based organizations. Yes, on the table.
Okay, let's see. Ngwase, thanks for being proud. You can go. Moi, je voudrais quand même te poser quelques questions. Et je viens par exemple au niveau de SIAF, qui a eu à mener beaucoup d'actions dans le domaine du mariage des enfants et de la législation générale féminine. Bon, parmi ces actions, il y a le plaidoyer que vous avez amené. Je voulais savoir quand même ce plaidoyer apporté sur quel thème particulièrement, parce que nous voudrions qu'on observe le mouvement à un niveau qu'on fasse ce plaidoyer pour se faire entendre. Ça, c'est la première préoccupation. Au niveau des jeunes, par exemple, comment ils s'organisent pour se faire entendre? Est-ce qu'il y a une certaine mobilisabilité de l'État auprès des jeunes? Comment les jeunes participent-ils hein, à ces genres d'actions pour se faire entendre au niveau de leur pays et pourquoi pas au niveau de la région? Y a-t-il un mécanisme de coordination de ces actions dans ces différents pays? Voilà donc les quelques préoccupations de ce que je vous dis. Merci.
Thank you very much. A question on youth involvement and how we can ensure their integration into policy making and decision making. We will respond to that. I'll take a couple of questions and come up to the panel. Yes, on the table at the back.
Thank you. Thank you for the presentation. My name is Judy Ojala. I work in West Africa in Senegal. What I wanted to contribute, having worked in West Africa for many years and some also in East and Southern Africa, as much as I think it's critical for youth to be involved in efforts to promote abandonment of child marriage, particularly girls, I think a reality in Africa that I've certainly learned not being African is the important role of elders in perpetuating sometimes positive traditions and sometimes harmful ones. And I think if the objective is to promote sustained change and collective change within communities, it's very important that the elders' role and influence be acknowledged and they be involved. And that we see them not only as obstacles, but as a resource. My organization is, just one more, not to be too long, but my organization is primarily Project Change Through Culture. And the idea being to use the positive things in culture to promote change. And we're involving an intergenerational approach, which I think is very important, that not only youth, but also elders be involved, so that together there's evolution in terms of change, in terms of norms around child marriage. Thank you.
Thank you. There was a question there. Yeah.
Bonjour à tous. Je suis Gakoto Richard, je suis leader jeu, je viens de la Centrafrique, je suis responsable de l'organisation nationale, désolé la Fondation des enfants d'abord. Mon intervention va s'articuler sur l'engagement des jeux, le cadre de collaboration avec les politiques au niveau national et au niveau continental. Je pense que les jeux nous sont l'épicentre de cette problématique mariage d'enfants. Ils sont à la fois acteurs et victimes. Et je veux beaucoup plus aborder la question dans le volet acteurs. Nous sommes en train de créer des dynamiques au niveau national, par exemple dans notre pays. Nous sommes en train de vouloir créer un mouvement qui lutte fortement contre le mariage d'enfants. Mais nous avons un certain nombre de difficultés au niveau de la collaboration avec les staffs politiques, c'est-à-dire les membres du gouvernement. Ils n'ont pas une considération pour notre apport sur cette question. Alors ma question est celle-ci, je veux savoir quel est le mécanisme qui peut être mis en place au niveau continental, voire au niveau sous-régional, pour faire un plaidoyer auprès des gouvernements afin de faciliter les échanges avec les organisations d'agir sur cette question, et non seulement au niveau régional, mais au niveau continental, à travers les marchés, pour pouvoir vraiment renforcer les mécanismes de suivi de plaidoyer auprès des gouvernements en faveur des organisations de la jeunesse pour appuyer les actions des jeunes et éradiquer ce qui est. Je vous remercie.
Merci.
Merci.
Thank you very much. I'm Anandita Philippos. I'm with the UNFPA's Regional Office for Western Central Africa, based in Dakar. I wanted to thank the panelists for a very engaging discussion and also for the fact that we touched upon how we can link up the work around child marriage, the Maputo Protocol, and the ongoing continental discussion around the democratic dividend. You mentioned how we can use these frameworks and protocols we can use child marriage as a way to revitalize the discussion around these protocols and frameworks. But I would also like to ask you about the reverse. How do we use the work that is ongoing at continental level around demographic dividend, around sexual and reproductive health issues as reflected in the Maputo Protocol, to also reposition child marriage as a critical intervention to ensure the well-being and health of young people on the continent? Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, next table, there's a gentleman.
Good morning. A question for the panel. So there are lots of reasons why child marriage remains very prevalent and why... So there are many reasons why child marriage remains highly prevalent and is not decreasing fast in Africa like it is in South Asia. And the question to me, from a practical point of view, is what's the alternative? What can parents or leaders do as a viable alternative to the current factors that lead to child marriage? To me, from qualitative work, case studies, programs that have been evaluated in depth, the main alternative is to keep the girls in secondary school. And I would like to have the views of the panel as to whether you see it the same way. And if that is the case, then that should really be the priority way to end child marriage in Africa.
Okay. Let's come forward and then we'll come back. I'll take a second round. Let's come forward first. This gentleman here. Or the lady at the table, right where you are. Yeah.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Selam, and I'm representing the Women's NGO Flying Blue from Ankara, Turkey. I'd like to ask you something about the campaign. Here in this global meeting, we say elders, we talk about, we talk as the adults, we talk about youth participation, but why don't we even articulate children? So what do you think about children's participation and engagement to the campaign specifically, and maybe to the other efforts globally to end child marriage? How can victims, child rights, engage to these efforts or to such campaigns? Thank you.
Thank you.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Noël, je viens du Tchad. Ma question concerne les politiques. Tout à l'heure, l'ambassadrice de la bonne volonté de l'Union africaine a mentionné certains pays qui ont pris des engagements importants pour mettre fin au mariage des enfants à la suite de la démarche de l'État du Tchad. Ma question concerne les engagements. C'est bien beau de prendre des engagements, mais l'application, c'est autre chose. Quand on prenait des engagements, il n'y a pas vraiment un suivi des engagements sur le terrain. Il y a des pays qui prennent des engagements qui disent que bon, moi je décide de mettre fin au mariage des enfants. Mais quand on partait sur le terrain, ces engagements ne sont pas respectés. Vous prenez le cas déjà pour 68% des cas de mariage des enfants qui continuent. Or, le président a pris une loi interdisant le mariage des enfants. Mais cette loi n'est pas vraiment suivie par la population. Je voudrais savoir quel est le mécanisme de suivi et l'application des lois qui sont prises au niveau national des pays respectivement. Quelle est l'éducation dans l'Union africaine sur ces engagements? Ça, c'est ma première question. La deuxième concerne les associations des jeunesses qui sont dans nos pays. Quelle est la collaboration des associations de la jeunesse entre les partenaires techniques et financiers, le gouvernement et ces associations de jeunes? Parfois, il y a des partenaires qui s'engagent de soutenir les associations de jeunes dans la lutte. Mais ces soutiens sont dilués dans le gouvernement. Le gouvernement considère parfois les associations de jeunesse comme si c'est des opposants. Parfois, les aides ne les parviennent pas. Et eux, ils sont des victimes. Je travaille pour l'IPPF et au niveau de l'IPPF, on dit que si tu n'inclus pas les victimes, qui travaille pour moi et qui ne m'implique pas est contre moi. Je voudrais que les partenaires, surtout techniques et financiers, essayent de voir d'une manière claire la collaboration entre le gouvernement, les associations de jeunes et les partenaires techniques et financiers. Merci.
We're going to take two last questions and then come back to the panel.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Lesité du Cameroun. Ce ne sont pas des questions, c'est des propositions. Première proposition, ressources. Ressources, mais avec le temps. Parce que nous sommes dans un processus de changement. Et le changement ne s'opère pas en un, deux, trois ans. Le docteur Passé l'a parlé, l'a dit tout à l'heure. Nous, on se connaît depuis les années 80. Ça ne se passe pas. Et imaginez, on a fait l'historique des concepts, des mots ce matin. À quel moment les mariages des enfants sont devenus? Donc, ressources va prendre en compte le temps, la durabilité. Deuxième observation, nous parlons de la volonté politique. Moi, mon association est sur le terrain. La volonté politique, oui, la ratification, on en a ratifié en Afrique. Mais vous savez aussi, avec moi, que les mêmes gouvernements qui ratifient, ce sont les mêmes gouvernements qui ont besoin des détenteurs d'influence auprès de nos populations. Ça veut dire que lors des élections, ces gouvernements ont besoin des autorités traditionnelles et religieuses pour avoir des voix. Alors arrêtons, nous, de la société civile, de nous amuser et de... Non, il faut des fonds à long terme pour que nous ayons des alliés comme autorités traditionnelles et religieuses. Et je pense à la on avait fait une proposition pour que les autorités traditionnelles et religieuses de l'Afrique centrale et de l'Afrique de l'Ouest puissent se retrouver, c'est-à-dire nos alliés. Sinon, on va toujours ratifier, mais ce sont ces autorités-là, traditionnelles et religieuses, qui ont une influence auprès des parents pour l'envoi des filles en mariage.
Thank you. We'll take the last question and then come on to the panel. We'll have a second round of questions, so I'm urging the panel to also be brief in your submission.
Hi, my name is Yvette. I work for UNICEF, Western Central African Office, based in Denver. So we've heard about the political realms, the legal commitments, the policy, the need for monitoring and evaluation, accountability. We've heard about the youth, the children, the elders. I'd like to bring the economic argument. And I'd like to look at this at the national level, but also at the family level. Because we also know that in our region, sometimes child marriage is actually an alternative. A family is faced with a poor menu of choices, and child marriage is one of them for the girls. It's either for protection, it's either because actually the family cannot feed their children. So I think that when we look at child marriage, we've heard also this morning about the costs. But we also need to look at the drivers. And I would like to ask the panelists here if we can reflect also on this economic argument. We know that there's a human rights issue, but there's also the point where some parents basically are mind off their daughter because this is the situation, and out of the poor choice that they have, this one is one of the choices. So I think we also need to address that, especially in Western Central Asia.
Okay, thank you very much. Linking the discussion that has just concluded with the question that has been raised on keeping girls in school as the alternative to child marriage. I just want to introduce a new twist to that, because we do know that in some cases child marriage happens not in instances of poverty, but just to save family honor, like to save the relationship that the family has within the community. So it's not really an issue of education or an issue of poverty. There are other issues that are driving child marriage in Africa, and we need to be cognizant of that. I'd like to open the floor now to our panelists to respond to some of the submissions that have been raised. With particular focus has been the issue of the youth. Where are the youth? How can the youth engage? Another question that came is, where are the children? How can they be not instrumentalized but become actors also in a discussion that really affects them? I don't want to summarize everything, but again, how can Maputo be used to revitalize the conversations on child marriage? Thank you for our viewers from home. We do have a question that's very particular on how can the AU and SADC work together to ensure that the modern law that has been put in place is implemented. So over to you. We'll begin with Catherine. How would you say to respond to some of the questions? Let's be brief so we can have a second round.
Yeah, thank you. So I'll start on the issue of youth participation. Just like any other actor, there is no one particular way of engaging young people. Like I mentioned earlier, we particularly see young people as beneficiaries, and often at the bottom of the pyramid, we consult them, and then we come here and say what they said. We don't have them on the panel articulating their priorities. So my challenge one is to the young people, for them to be engaged, and also for the actors in the room, to also see young people as an audience that you need to advocate for. As the gentleman in blue mentioned, is that young people are also part of these social norms and they are part of reproducing them. So when devising a youth strategy, you also need to put the part where you're actually advocating to young people. For donors, there has to be the part where you're actually investing in young people, not through other organizations, but in their own movements. We don't have that enough. We normally have young people, they are funded through a proxy organization, they're not having their own resources, so there isn't sustained engagement, there is no sustained way of engaging. In terms of government, there is an importance for young people to engage in government. I think, like I said, there's no one way of just ensuring that you're participating at the community level. There has to be a deliberate effort to be part of government delegation so that when policies are being discussed, you're part of those conversations. And I think it's for us to always see youth engagement as comprehensive. And I want to emphasize, Andrew, emphasize the need for meaningful youth participation. And the final comment on youth participation is that don't just reinforce some of these some of these things we see, for example, we only have, we have most of the experts, we have big men. That's because a lot of the youth who are experts on this issue or who are bold enough to do the activism and who have the opportunity to be able to move upwards are young men. So we need to be able to engage young people, including young girls, to start speaking early so that you have a balanced voice from the young people as well. And on the issues of drivers, I like the comment on the economic angle, but the other angle we don't emphasize enough is the patriarchal angle. That when you have the choice you have, and the choice that's easy to make is to commodify girls. And I think in, when having this 3-day meeting, it's important for us to always gravitate back and mention and just reaffirm to ourselves and the root cause of why it is the girls who are the ones who are easy to give away. It's because we have seen girls as objects. We've seen girls as we put a price on the girls. And so as we start to think about the drivers, we have to also ensure that we consistently are grounded on the fact that it's a patriarchal society that get us to this angle. And so I personally don't would like for, to hear what the answers of the alternatives are, because the alternative for child marriage is to end child marriage. I don't think we have to replace bad practices with others, but that's just my opinion and FEMNET. So I'd like just to hear what other panelists have to say. And finally, in terms of mechanisms for engaging, there are different mechanisms at the national level and regional level and sub-regional, but I also think we don't talk about the sub-national. A lot of the work we do should be grounded on the daily lived reality of women and girls, so that when we start having the conversation, what is grounding us is the voice of the girl, the future of the girl, the fate of the girl, and the change we want to bring in the lives of girls and women. So I think for me, that's the ground that needs to start from there. And so it's not just about the global or the regional or the national, but also the subnational and the household. And finally, the individual life and fate of the girl with, for whom we are currently discussing. On the issue of demographic dividend and how that can be an opportunity and reverting back, I personally find a challenge when we articulate concepts like demographic dividend in broad terms, like health, governance, you know, and those are the pillars we articulate. And the governments have to go back and granulate themselves. So what would be helpful would be for agencies like UNFPA, who put out this very complex subject, to also have the conversation with government as to what as to the place of child marriage looks like in that. If you look at many of the national roadmaps for governments, you rarely see this child marriage being the core as to how they pivot it. Because what it becomes is an economic argument. The entire concept of demographic dividend is very technical. It locks out very many voices, the women's rights voices, the youth themselves voices. And so if you look at the voices we have at the table are voices of population experts and demographers. And so what needs to happen is for us to start simplifying and rebranding these concepts for them to be friendly. And also, there needs to be a deliberate platform for ensuring there's youth engagement. And I don't mean just youth engagement for consultation, but youth expert involvement. At FEMNET, what we did with the demographic dividend, we had additions as to the AU roadmaps, additions for the particular investment that would be key in terms of ensuring the demographic dividend works for adolescent girls and young women. And so if there was engagement from the wide goal as to what the perspectives of adolescent girls and young women are when formulating these concepts, we have a much better traction. Because what is left is for us to start injecting these additions later, because governments don't have this lens at the beginning. So I would personally say that when we articulate this, let's not do that through. Let's not say governance. What does that governance look like? What is health? Because when you say health, most governments will go to vaccines, right? And that's not HPV, for example. That's vaccines for other things. And so I think there's an opportunity from the other end for us to inject this. But if the way the concepts are framed, popularized, is friendly, and not just youth friendly, but friendly to all the actors who will be friendly in terms of implementing them, and who will be an actor in terms of ensuring that they are successful. Thank you.
Thanks, Catherine. I think we've adequately covered the conversation around the youth, but Nyaradzayi, maybe you can tell us, where are the children in this conversation? What has Rozaria done to be able to push the voices of the children?
Thank you so much,
and maybe in that breath I can also respond to a number of other issues that have been raised. Just to acknowledge that in our presence are also members of the AU Civil Society Reference Group. Can they just raise and wave where they are? Because I think as we move forward in the new discourse around some. So just to, there were a couple of questions, and I want to start with the issue of children and then respond to the issue of resources and the issue of accountability. Again, it's a child. So children are the center of the conversation we are having. When we say child marriage, we're talking about a child. We're talking about children. But we're not talking about the individual child. We're talking about a child having a child. So it's very important in our thinking that the work on child marriage is just focused on this child getting married, but we did not address the whole issues of pregnancy, of that child raising a child, the infant mortalities, the morbidities, a whole range of child development issues. I did a study on the mental health impact of child marriage. It was painful to see how we've not yet even gone into the full range of discussions around children. When a child is 14 and she is widowed or divorced, does she get custody of her own child? So there are a number of issues around children that we have not fully started to address. Secondly, the intergenerational dimension of child marriage. At times I get very uncomfortable. We speak as if the trauma and the experience and the impact stops when the child becomes, stops being a child. Child marriage is about a violation of rights that has lifelong impact for that woman. So I feel an inadequacy in the way we are addressing the issue, because child marriage is about violence against women in their lifetime. My mother, at 83, had not yet closure about how she married my father. At 83, an 83-year-old woman, if we were to do a survey at this conference, how many women were married off in this conference who are still traumatized, would be shocked. So as Africa, where we say in some countries, Niger, Burkina, Mozambique and others, prevalence way beyond 40%. We are talking about women experiencing, millions of women who have experienced child marriage. So I think for Africa we need to go beyond just prevention, but also to address the consequences of child marriage for the people who have experienced child marriage. This is why it's very important that we have the forthcoming Girls Summit of the AU. And I think it should be a space for us in Africa to say it's our time. Time is now for us to deepen the conversation and to rethink the future in a deeper way on various issues. Where are still on the child, the most sensitive issue which we are not naming is child marriage is about children and sexuality. We are afraid to talk about adolescents and sex. We are afraid to think about it. And so we just avoid that discussion. And then child marriage becomes a manifestation, teenage pregnancy and all this. But we have to talk about the sexual reproductive health and rights, comprehensive sexuality education. These are the real issues on the table that we need to talk about to be comfortable with. And within that, we need also to see who are the men who are marrying our children? We always talk about the girls, but who are these men? They are 90%, I've not done the survey, but 99% is adult men. Maybe there is a 5% or so of teenagers having sex. But honestly, these are adult men who are praying over our girls. We cannot be diplomatic about an abuse. And so I think that shift is also important for us to talk about who are they and why is this happening? The last one, the last two issues, poverty, household poverty, I'm actually raised the question also. Let's debunk this myth around the, we need to debunk some myths. No family ever gets rich by marrying off their daughter. It's a myth. You get 5 goats and 3 chickens and $20. And after you've married off your daughter, she comes home to look for soap and money for grinding millet. Honestly, child marriage is recreating poverty. And we should not sustain the myth that child marriage gets families out of poverty, because it doesn't. It creates more poverty. And that's what we need to rename in our advocacy, a civil society, is how child marriage is recreating poverty. And still, and say, no. Marrying off your daughter, you will not get you out of poverty. Sending her to school will get you out of poverty. Marrying her will not get you out of poverty. The issue of resources. You know what? I said it out there. Africa is not poor. Our own money. Our own governments are not making the right decisions. Let's say it. Upfront and clear. Reclaiming the dignity of Africa is when Africa's own resources starts to be invested for Africa's own people. Our oil, our diamonds, I live in the village where there's gold. Our gold must be processed there in value addition in Africa. We should stop resending our imports out of Africa and not generating value out of our own exports. So we need to rethink the extensive leakage in our economy. The Mbeki report talked about billions of illicit financial flows out of Africa. World Bank, can you deal with those money which is getting out of Africa so that that money remains on Africa? Proper contracting and ensuring procurement does not have these leakages on just justice. Corruption, we have mega corruption. So we need to plug the leakages in our economy for our own money and our own resources. And really, we don't want external people plundering Africa. When you come to Africa, invest responsibly. If you are doing mining, the mining place should have a school. At times it's on the plantations and in the mines where we don't have schools. And this is millions of money getting out of Africa. This for me is repositioning the conversation on child marriage, because addressing household poverty requires us to rethink this conversation. Money coming for development, UNFPA and UNICEF, you have been running the joint program. How are you supporting civil society? How are we involved as communities in the joint program? This is huge money. This is extensive work. How is our communities? At times things just stop at the national level. In the village, we just hear there's something happening, but we don't really feel it. Spotlight Initiative is with us. A big resource. And for Africa, it prioritized these issues, including child marriage. Will the Spotlight Initiative really be accessible to communities? How? This the designing of the Spotlight Initiative. I have my Zimbabwean colleagues here. A Kenya working on from norms and violence. A Beatrice working from economic. And there is Chinga working from justice. Each one of them, I see them running after 5 shillings. You know? Each one of them is struggling on their own. But is it really that we don't have resources? Resources are there, but there is no systematic, substantive way in which the Kenyans and the Beatrices can have a significant. To say, here is a million, we trust, go do the stuff that needs to be done in your community. We have to shift the relationship, shift the conversation, create the opportunities for that resource to be there. Last, my brother from Chad, you challenged me. And a point also from Doris in our conclusion. You know, all these baskets of policies we have, whether it's the Maputos and they are important, but they are insufficient. I'm an international human rights lawyer. I want to see where the law can be enjoyed. That's where we want to be. And not only where the law can be known. Knowing the law does not change my life. It only helps me to try to claim my rights. We want people to enjoy their rights. But currently, a lot of the discourse is around awareness of the rights. So we have to move beyond awareness to accessing services. And for that to happen, we need stronger advocacy by civil society. It will not just happen on its own. We need shadow reports. Yes, we need our governments in the AU to do the report and a stronger accountability mechanism. We need that. But we also need to have our own scorecard, our own shadow report, something we stand on, and we can push the issues and show the facts and the figures and say, this is unacceptable. Some of us were not born with any name that can be recognized. You know, there are names which are recognized, which are political names and others. We were born with the only inheritance we had was to know that you can have your first period without a pet. And that is no longer acceptable. There are millions of us, people like me, who are saying another world is possible. We belong, we insist, we claim, and we continue to say the uncomfortable issues. Saying truth to power, including ourselves as power, is where the change has to happen. And really on education, yes, we need education, but not education for which our governments can have loans. So I want resourcing in education, but not to indebt our countries with loans in education or with loans in health. Let's do loans for other things. So financing should not come with conditionalities that continues to keep that child and that family involved.
Yeah. Thank you very much. I've been informed by my producers we have 2 minutes. So I'll give the 2 minutes to Dr. Kouyate and patients. Unfortunately, we will come back to a second round. But I want to urge you to continue having these conversations. There will be plenty of other sessions on Africa taking place within the program where we can pick up some of these conversations. So if you can, unfortunately.
Merci beaucoup. Je crois que notre discussion peut durer. Ça, c'est sur d'autres sujets qu'on pourrait le faire. Quand on parle de la corruption en Afrique, du fait qu'on a des ressources, qu'on n'arrive pas à bien gérer, ça c'est une grosse question. Ceux qui produisent le pétrole, ils ont un groupe de producteurs de pétrole, ils se réunissent, ils fixent les prix. Mais le cacao qui est fabriqué, qui est cultivé en Afrique, en Côte d'Ivoire, la Côte d'Ivoire ne peut pas fixer le prix. Le prix est fixé à New York. C'est à New York qu'on fixe le prix pour le cultivateur de cacao en Côte d'Ivoire. Donc, le système mondial est tel que l'Afrique est condamnée, nous sommes bloqués. Ça, ça doit changer. Dieu merci, les choses sont en train de changer maintenant. Alors, pour ça, c'est une autre question. Ce que je voudrais dire, c'est qu'on ne peut pas, il ne faut pas être naïf non plus. Ne pensons pas que ce sont les chefs d'État qui vont aller porter plainte parce qu'une fille a été mariée en bas âge, c'est pas comme ça. L'Union africaine a fait déjà ce qu'elle devait faire. L'année dernière, 2017, c'était la présidence de la Guinée. Le président de la Guinée a désigné un champion, un chef d'État, président Lungu, sur les questions de mariage d'enfants. Ça, c'est un message très fort que nous avons reçu. Quand nous venons maintenant au niveau des pays, il faut qu'on change un peu. Si on ne change pas de paradigme, nous serons là encore en 2040 en train de faire les mêmes réunions, les mêmes conférences. Quand j'entends programme, impliquons les jeunes, impliquons les femmes, impliquons les leaders religieux, qui les implique? Qui est au centre de ça? Qui?
On peut pas impliquer les victimes alors que ce sont elles qui sont au centre. C'est elles qui doivent être au centre. Normalement, ce sont les victimes, ce sont les jeunes qui devraient être au centre de ça et qui nous impliquent, nous les hommes, nous les leurs religieux, etc., etc. Donc il faut changer le paradigme. On ne peut pas faire des programmes avec l'UNEPIE, avec l'UNICEF, avec le gouvernement, et on s'assoit, on dit où sont les voilà, mariages d'enfants, les jeunes, vous venez avec nous. Non, mais c'est un problème des jeunes. C'est les jeunes qui doivent être au centre. Ça, c'est deux. La troisième chose, lorsque le cadre est créé par les politiques, c'est tout. Il faut que les citoyens, surtout en Afrique, apprennent à se défendre eux-mêmes. C'est ça qui est important. N'attendons pas que ce soit un ministre qui vienne protéger la fille. Il y a eu un fait extrêmement important qui s'est passé il y a 2 mois en Guinée qui mérite d'être cité en Afrique et dans le monde, dans la lutte contre les mariages d'enfants. Une fille devait être mariée, on devait la sortir de l'école pour la marier. Il y a 2 mois, hein, c'est pas 5 ans, il y a 2 mois. Ses collègues, filles et jeunes garçons de l'école se sont organisés, sont allés porter plainte contre les parents de la fille. Et les écoles ont donné leur mais il y a eu un grand mouvement pour dire non au mariage de cette jeune fille. Elle n'a pas été mariée. C'est ça que nous devons faire. Il faut que les victimes soient là, que le citoyen, la citoyenne puisse dire ça c'est mon droit, je veux le défendre. Parce que on a passé 20 ans à présenter les femmes comme étant des pauvres personnes, les femmes doivent être aidées, supportées. Mais comment aider, supporter? On a déjà violé leurs droits. On ne reconnaît pas leur place. Mais ce n'est pas les aider. Il s'agit de restaurer leurs droits. Les jeunes. Ah, il faut qu'on amène les jeunes, on leur donne une part. Non, leurs droits sont déjà violés. C'est ça qu'il faut restaurer. Je pense que nous devons changer de paradigme. Et la dernière chose que je voulais dire, je vais finir par là parce qu'il est cessons de penser que les enfants sont la propriété de leurs parents. Ça aussi, ça doit changer. Ce ne sont pas des objets qui appartiennent à leurs parents. Ce sont des personnes humaines comme leurs parents. C'est ça qui doit changer. Donc, c'est pas, il ne faut pas prier les parents pour leur dire pardon, ne faites pas ça. Les parents doivent être devant la loi, devant la force de la loi pour les empêcher de marier précocement leur enfant. Voilà ce que je voulais dire. Merci.
Thank you very much. I will try to be very brief. I just want to emphasize what my colleagues have said, that you know, when we are addressing child marriages, we really need to use a life cycle approach. It's a violation of women throughout their lives, so we must start from with children. We need to be raising awareness, protecting them, and move right up to all the women as well as people who are custodians of culture and so forth. So we shouldn't just intervene maybe in the adolescent age group, but we should use a life cycle approach. And then the other thing that I wanted to talk about, which my colleagues have also kind of highlighted, is really around accountability, keeping our governments accountable to commitments that they have made. I mean, if they have ratified the Maputo Protocol, we need to see them implementing it. So we've got an important role in monitoring implementation of treaties that our countries are party to. But we also have an important role, and we can do this monitoring by either participating in the report writing process itself or developing shadow reports or alternative reports to treaty bodies, highlighting the challenges of a particular issue that we are facing in our countries. But also, I think we also need to use a lot of different approaches. And one of the approaches that we don't usually think about is the use of complaints mechanisms. And also the litigating, sometimes we need to be using aggressive methods to do this issue. So these are some of the things that I think we should start thinking about as we take this work forward. And also we should be pushing for things that we haven't been talking about a lot. So for example, things, issues such as reparations and restitutions for girls who have been victims of child marriage, girls who have survived child marriage. Do we have services for them to be able to get out of these marriages if they so wish? So those are some of the conversations that we should also be thinking of as we are going forward, but really we need to keep our governments accountable. They have got specific obligations that they've agreed to. We want to see them actually implementing this. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much. That's it from us here at GNZTV. Before you leave the station, I would like to acknowledge your active participation and facilitation provided by the interpreters. Let's give ourselves a round of applause. Please take some good news to share. This talk show has been nominated for an award at the Daytime Emmys. But for us to win, we have to go through a process. Kindly open your browsers. We were taken through this at the opening ceremonies. Go to sli.do. Type in GNB 2018, as that is the code that will allow us to vote for the evaluation of this talk show. Also, make sure to fill in your contact details in the registration form that has been going around or will be at the back of the room. For those who do not have a phone or computer, the evaluation forms are also on the table, so kindly fill those in before you leave. You may stand a chance to win a brand new car. So make sure you do that. For us here, see you next time. And remember, don't wait for tomorrow to make a change. Start today, rise up, and join the movement to enter marriage everywhere. Thank you very much for your active participation. Yeah, you can dance, I guess, if you want.